Hi, in this video I'm going to talk about my process or workflow for producing a new track in my home studio. I'll give a high-level overview of how I record, how I mix and master, and what needs to be done before and after that. So let's go! Okay, welcome to episode 9 of my new song production series, which is a series of videos in which I show you all the steps that I do to produce a new song for my band Awash. So far, I've already shown you how I start the whole song production with a Cubase project, and then how we record all the various instruments that are featured in the track. And I will link a playlist at the end of this video, so you can have a look at all the steps that have been done already. But when you've watched the series before, I can imagine that you may be wondering where all of this is going, and why I did not do this or that yet, or basically, where are we in the full song production? So that's basically why I decided to make this video, so you get a bit of a high-level overview of all the steps that I go through from start to finish, and which steps are still to follow, and how far we are in the whole production process. And I hope it will also give you some ideas if you compare it to your own way of working. And if you have any remarks or questions, or would like to tell me how you work, I would really love to hear about that in the comments below. Okay, as for the main steps that I'm using in my music production process, I think nobody will be surprised if you have a look. Because the main steps are obviously recording, then mixing, then mastering. And I have to say that this process I'm going to tell you about is really the way I like to do it, and how I've learned to do it in all these years producing tracks in my home studio. So there's no right or wrong, and others may do it in an entirely different way. Now, if you look at these main steps, I really try to keep a very clear separation between recording, mixing and mastering. And that mainly has to do with focus. I want to really focus on recording during the recording stage and not worry about mixing. During the mixing stage, I want to focus on mixing and not about still needing to do a lot of recordings or already trying to get the loudness up, which is normally a mastering step. And the same thing for mastering. If I do the mastering myself, I really don't want to focus on individual tracks anymore. I want to really focus on getting that stereo track, the output of the mixing stage, sound as good as possible. And what I'm going to show you, even I may change this process every once in a while, as I'm learning more or circumstances change. So during recording, I may already put some effects on tracks, like compression or some reverb for the vocals, so that the tracks sound a bit better, because other musicians need to record to these tracks. But all of that work, at the end of the recording stage, I remove it, faders go down to zero, and I start from scratch at the mixing phase. Now, if you look at these three steps and you've done some music production yourself, you may notice that some steps are actually missing. And in the next slide, you can see what actually happens before recording, at least when we're recording a track from my band. Obviously, the song, the track, needs to be written. It needs to be arranged, so every player needs to find his own part for the song. It needs to be rehearsed so that we can comfortably play it during recording. And if an outside producer is involved, there may also be some pre-production, where the producer comes to rehearsal and comments on songs, and maybe some parts are still changed before the initial recording sessions. With my band Awash, though, I have to say that we really do the production ourselves usually, and it really happens during the other steps, during rehearsal and during arranging. We also come up with parts that we think sound good on recording. Now, after the mastering, there are usually also some steps that need to be done, which I'm not going into in too much detail. And some of these steps can actually happen during the whole production process or during the last steps of the production process. And now I'm talking about making sure that all admin is done for the track, like registering copyrights, performance rights, etc., etc. This also may depend on which country you live in, how this is done. You have to arrange distribution. Digital distribution via some aggregator like DistroKid or CD Baby, so that your track is released to Spotify, Deezer, Apple Music, etc. But maybe it's also physical distribution that needs to be arranged to make sure that your album or even vinyl is put in record stores or sold online somewhere. And of course, there's everything around the release moment that needs to be arranged. For example, maybe there's a party, you have to arrange artwork for your release, maybe even flyers or whatever special things that you want. And because you're releasing a track, you also want it to be heard and you want people to listen to it. So it's also a good idea to do some promotion. And this can be by means of a video clip maybe, or Facebook ads or Google ads or whatever promotion you want to do. Now, when it comes to recording, we've really done it in two very different ways with our band. One is the more traditional approach, which we did when we rented a studio. And in that case, we recorded a lot of the tracks live. So everybody was playing together in the studio, and at least the basic tracks of that recording were used. And afterwards, some tracks were overdubbed, like extra additional parts, or maybe the vocals, because the singer could then focus more on giving a great vocal performance. Now, it's still nice to have the singer sing along when the rest of the band is recording the basic tracks, so they can get more into the feel of the song and really get the feeling of playing together with the full band, like in a rehearsal. The overdubs can be done in the same studio, maybe even the same day, but sometimes the overdubs are done in a completely different studio or much later in time. Now, since this series is really about home recording studios, this is not the way we do it in our home studios. In our home studios, it's more this way that we're recording, and that means that all the various instruments and parts are recorded separately. Sometimes they're even recorded in different home studios. Now, as for the order, we usually like to start with drums, because that forms the basis of all other instruments. So our drummer usually has to go first and deliver his part first. Afterwards, the bass is added. Then, the other instruments, which can be in any order really, depending a bit on who's the quickest to start the recording. After that, we do the lead vocal, because it's nice for the singer to already have a complete track to sing to, so that he can get into it a bit more and deliver the best vocal performance, because really that's what it's all about in our style of music. And because the backing vocals usually have to be synced to the lead vocal, we do them last. Now, I have to say that for the current song that you're seeing being produced in this whole series, we did things a little bit differently with the drums, because the drummer, as you can see in this diagram, has to go first. And that means he can't really feed on the recordings of the other instruments. So what he did this time is that he delivered a basic drum track so that all the other instruments could record to that. And then at the end, he will still go over his drum part and change some subtle details so that it's more in line with all the other recorded parts. After recording, I start mixing, and I do that by taking all faders down and taking all effects off that I may have applied during recording, just to get a bit of a better sound for the performers. But at mixing, I really start from scratch, and I usually have two phases in which I mix. I first start by making a static mix, which basically means that the levels of all the tracks are staying mostly the same during the whole song. So I find the right level for the vocals, for the guitars, for the drums, etc. And I'm just focusing on the sounds of all the individual instruments and how they gel together and make them sound good together, without really doing too much automation, because automation is something that I focus more on when I'm making the dynamic mix. So if you look at what I'm doing during the static mix, first thing I do is I put on some essential bus effects, and that's usually my analog compressor and EQ. So I really mix into the compressor so that I have that sound from the get-go, basically. After that, I focus on the kick drum. Then I add the bass guitar, so that I can make the kick drum and the bass guitar really gel and work well together, so that they don't overlap in frequency, for example, and that kick doesn't push away the bass guitar or the other way around. Then I add all the other drums and the overheads. Next, I usually put up the lead vocal in the mix, because I feel the lead vocal, especially for the music that we do, is the most important part, really. So I really want to get that working from the get-go, at least after the really basic tracks have been added, like drums and bass. And then I usually add the lead vocal and make that sound as well as possible with equalizer, compressor, effects like reverb, delay, and things like that. And then after, when I add all the other instruments, I can really determine how they affect the lead vocal, and if I need to do something special to make sure that the prominence and the impact of the lead vocal is preserved throughout the track. And in general, that's actually also why I like to work this way, so that I can focus on each instrument individually first, and then whenever I add the next instrument, I can see what changes, and that every instrument is heard in the production in the way that it is supposed to be heard. Okay, after the lead vocal, I start adding all the other instruments, and really making sure that they gel with the rest. Then I add the backing vocals, and finally I add the rest of my bus processing, which may be something like a tape emulator or stereo widening or any really general effect that I want on everything. Now, this is the basic sequence in which I do things, but it doesn't mean I don't go back to an instrument which I've already done if I hear that it needs to be changed when I add other instruments to the mix. Because I can't fully complete, for example, a lead vocal if I haven't heard it yet together with the guitars. So when I add the guitars, maybe I also change something in the lead vocal again to make sure that it keeps being as prominent as I want it to be. Now, after all the instruments are in the mix and I've tried to shape them as well as possible and make sure that they gel together, I start a dynamic mix. And if you look at that, there's no really set order to anything I do during the dynamic mix. But the intention of the dynamic mix changes is that I usually add automation to support the song dynamics. So if there's like a build-up in the song, for example, I may support it by adding volume automation or even effect automation to kind of underline that build-up. Or I may give some extra impact to breaks. So really for me, the dynamic mix is about putting icing on the cake, and it's probably 10-20% of the whole mixing process, and the rest really happens in the static mix. Now again, this is the way I work. I'm not saying that this is the way you should work or that everybody else works like this, because there are also really totally other ways to do the mixing. For example, there's also the top-down mixing approach. I will link a video of Joe Gilder of the Home Studio Corner at the end of this video so that you can have a look at that, because in that approach you really put up all tracks. You basically have a rough mix, maybe that you've already made during the recording stage, and then you leave that up and you start fine-tuning from the end of the chain. So you start by fine-tuning the bus processing, see if you can adjust the mix by just doing stuff on the bus, and then you go to the groups, like you start doing fine-tuning for drums in general, guitars in general, vocals in general, and then to do even more fine-tuning, only then you go to all the other tracks, like for example the kick and the snare, all the different backing vocals, to do more fine-tuning there, and that's called top-down mixing. I've never done it this way myself, but it sounds quite interesting. Okay, the last stage of the music production process for me is mastering. Let's have a look. I have to say that we rarely do this ourselves, especially when we're making a serious studio production. When I've done the mix, I've usually heard the track about 300 to 400 times during the mixing on all kinds of systems. It's really good to get in an extra set of fresh ears, so we usually outsource the mastering. But during mastering, what basically happens is that the mastering engineer balances the track, meaning that he listens to the exported stereo file of the mixing stage, and he checks that the frequencies are all okay, that it's not too shrill, not too bass heavy, not too muddy. Obviously, you try to make sure that that's not the case during mixing, but after a while you may lose some perspective, or maybe there's a little imperfection in your mixing setup. And he's really the quality control at the end of the line of the music production. So he makes sure that everything is balanced, he brings it up to loudness. You can also make sure that the new track is in line with all the other tracks that you need to have on the album, so that all the tracks of a collection, an EP or an album, sound good together, that they put in the right sequence with the right gaps in between them, etc., etc. And then there's also still some technical things that he might do. He might, for example, add ISRC codes or CD text to an image of the album or the EP, so that it can be used, for example, in a reproduction plan for CDs or vinyl. And that's pretty much it for a high-level overview of the music production process, the way I do it in my home studio. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up, subscribe to the channel, it really helps me out on YouTube, and if you want to make sure you don't miss any of the other videos, ring the little bell icon so you get notified when I post another video. Now, the next playlist on your right here contains all the steps in the new song production series that have already been done prior to this video, and depending on when you watch this, it may also contain some steps that I've done after producing this video. So have a look at that. See you soon.